Welcome this time for the Legal Lounge here on CRN Digital Talk Radio, CRNTalk.com, streaming live coast to coast and around the world on CRNTalk.com. Also available in stunning high-definition video on our custom CRN Roku channel. Also available on Tiki Live and CRNTalk.com. I'm joined, as always, he's a practicing attorney, a noted author, a constitutional scholar, semi-professional conga player, Corvette, and Porsche aficionado, Mr. Richard Nixon. Sir, how are you?
The one and only Richard A. Nixon.
That's
Thank
correct.
You. Well, we've got a little bit of good news this week. Someone who used to work for President Trump, his name is Stephen Miller, who's the current president of the First American Legal Foundation, has brought a lawsuit against the Biden administration and essentially contains a number of claims that the country is without any security on its southern border, and that the people want security at their home, at the border, in their homes, at their schools, and we have an unprecedented number of people flooding in. And according to what he cites as a statistic, there's something like 42 million people who would like to come to the U.S. if permitted, and we simply can't allow that to happen. He's part of what he's arguing is we've got to stop that. In addition to that, he's claiming we've got to stop catch and release, where all the person has to do, that is to say an illegal alien, when he is met at the border, all he has to do is say asylum, and he's caught, if you will, and then he's given a mini hearing, and he's released to come back in a couple years, which rarely do any of them come back. I mean, the amount of people that actually return for that hearing are like 2%. So he's basically in the country without being permitted to be here, frankly. We want to end that. But, of course, you mentioned some other things, Mike, that are negative as far as his position is concerned.
Well, yeah, I want to circle back to that. But just real fast, Richard, there's laws on the books, both federal statutes and state statutes, saying that
Correct.
You can't come to this country unless you get permission, right?
Correct.
But yet, it seems that the Biden administration is flouting those laws.
Yes.
And what I think Stephen Miller is trying to do here is he's not trying to change laws through the courts. He's actually trying to get President Biden and the Biden administration and the Biden Justice Department to enforce laws already on the books.
Well, I don't know what you mean by through the courts. He's actually filed a lawsuit.
Yeah, so that's what I mean. He's not trying to get the courts actually, you know, change law. He's getting
That's correct.
Trying to make the Biden administration follow laws that are already in the books.
That's correct. And of course, we know that a president's not following the law. Now, remember, the president is not supposed to make law. He is supposed to, he's passive, and he is supposed to apply the law as the Congress has written. Only Congress, not the courts, but only Congress. And here it's clear, I think, that there's several statutes that Mr. Biden and his administration are violating. That would include Ms. Harris. And quite frankly, he could be setting them up for impeachment if the, I know that's the big word, impeachment,
okay.
The I word. If the Republicans ever gain control of the Senate and the House, he may be on his way out in 2 years.
Interesting. I want to talk a little bit more about that. The impeachment and also immigration in two cases you brought to our attention of the Ninth Circuit, Dawson versus Garland or Romero versus Garland here on the Legal Lounge. We'll also talk about the Fourth Amendment later in the show. So stick around, you guys. We're here in the Legal Lounge, CRN Digital Talk Radio, CRNTalk.com. Stay with us.
For the getaway of your dreams, come to Hawaii's Playground, Ka'anapali Beach Resort, on the fun side of Maui, where the world comes to play. Find your spot on Ka'anapali Beach with 3 miles of white sand, 12 resort properties, 2 golf courses, and 2 shopping centers. Enjoy the playground of Hawaii's ancient royalty. Ka'anapali Beach Resort is Hawaii's original master planned destination resort and home of the Hawaii Food and Wine Festival. With views of 2 neighboring islands, you can breathe in the land's natural beauty from your favorite resort or golf fairway. Come experience Ka'anapali's own special brand of Hawaiian hospitality with world-class dining, relaxing resorts, water sports, and activities of every kind. For romantic, family, and great friend getaways, discover the options of Ka'anapali Beach Resort, where the world comes to play. Plan your getaway today. Visit KaanapaliResort.com. That's K-A-A-N-A-P-A-L-I Resort.com.
And we are back in the Legal Lounge, CRN Digital Talk Radio, CRNTalk.com, streaming live coast to coast and around the world on CRNTalk.com and on bevy of platforms. Richard, since you brought up impeachment,
yes,
we got to talk about this just real fast because this has been blowing up social media.
Yes,
this comes from this idea was first floated by a friend of the show and radio personality Wayne Allen Roots, and actually Steve Bannon has been talking about a lot too. They floated the idea that President Trump, or former President Trump, I should say, or depending on your worldview.
Right.
That he should run for a House seat in Florida, which he would win. I mean, he could find a district in Florida, and he'd win by 75 points.
Right.
And he would be elected to Congress in 2022. He would then be elected, probably as a lead pipe cinch, to be Speaker of the House if he wanted to.
Yes.
And 2022, based on a bevy of different historical factors and also based on redistricting, it aims to be a very, very successful year for both Republicans in the House and the Senate.
Yes.
So the scenario is, reported by Wayne Allen Roots and Steve Bannon and others, is that Trump becomes Speaker of the House. Republicans take both houses of Congress.
Yes.
They impeach Biden and Kamala for maybe some of the issues that you just mentioned.
Yes.
And now we have President Trump back as president.
Wow, that's excellent.
And just breaking right now, Trump yesterday was approached about this. He was asked about this, and he says, quote, "That's so interesting," end quotes.
Oh, that's interesting. That is interesting. And I'm sorry. I thought I came up with a relatively unique situation where the most I could get was Trump back in 2024 and the impeachment of the House and Senate in 2022, impeachment, I should say, of Biden and Harris. And that would give President Trump in 2024 a Republican Congress, period. But that's the best I could do is to install Mr. Trump in 2024. But I think this one is even better.
Yeah, it's quite interesting scenario. It's funny how things work out sometimes. Let's get back to this immigration. You mentioned something, Richard, about catch and release.
Yes.
And catch and release is a policy where an illegal immigrant is captured and, you know, first of all, he's violated federal law by coming to the country illegally. Usually he's also, you know, nabbed in some sort of crime, you know, other than that, like a DUI or something like that.
Right.
And what happens is that they say, hey, you know, you're here illegally, we're going to deport you. And the immigrant, you know, says the magic word about asylum.
Yes.
And then the immigration officials have to hold an asylum hearing and all sorts of, and as this process plays out, the illegal immigrant is then released back into society.
Right.
Back into American soil. And the lefty argument against that, against catch and release, is that when you release these illegal immigrants back, you know, into society on our side of the border, they are effectively living on the run.
Correct.
They are not taking part in any social civil society, really. They become very exploitative, where because they cannot, you know, apply for a legal job with you know, Social Security and whatnot, they end up working for slave wages. They end up maybe being subject to human trafficking.
They're living in the shadows.
Living in the shadows. That's the perfect term for that. So what do we do about catch and release?
Well, my old buddy Ann Coulter, I haven't heard from her in a long time. I don't know where she might be writing another book. But one of the things she suggested some time ago is that we authorize these illegals that are in our midst to file suit against their employers for not paying them what would be normal union wages. So in other words, instead of $15 an hour, they're getting $3 an hour. They would be allowed to sue their employers. That would certainly dry up the situation where if you get enough employees suing their employers for wages, that would do a number of things. First of all, it would force the employer to either pay the illegal the $15 an hour, but there would be no advantage to the employer hiring an illegal, and that would solve another problem, that is continuing to pay the union people, the citizens, their due wages. So far, nothing's happened on that score, but I think it's a good idea.
Would the illegal immigrant have standing, though, even as a not U.S. citizen?
That's what she's saying, that you have to just give him standing under Article 3. Again, it could result in a lawsuit. But again, he is, if you will, or she, does have injury because she's being paid less than the other people that are here legally. On the other hand, do we want to authorize that? And again, if Congress does that, it's debatable, but it could happen.
Is immigration, the policy of immigration, is that ever discussed in the U.S. Constitution?
It is. It's under Article 1, Section 8. And again, we've mentioned this way early in our shows, Mike, that people forget this, but immigration was intended to benefit the country and not the immigrant. I know that sounds cold-hearted, but the United States, like any other country, has a right to pick and choose which people it wants to come here based upon the United States' need. Do we need engineers? Who's producing engineers that are willing to come here? If it turns out to be South Korea or Japan, that's where we're going to pick. And we don't have to be bothered, that is to say, the Department of Secretary of State doesn't have to be bothered with equal protection. He doesn't have to, although left tries to equate that.
The equal protection argument would be in like, hey, if you take one person over here but not another person over here, my equal protection is violated.
Exactly, and that's what the left has tried to do, is if you're going to get a person from South Korea, then you have to get another person from Mexico or whatever. And again, they're ignoring the fact that the country is picking these people because they have particular skills that the country needs at the time.
Yeah, I mean, we've done this before. I mean, the Chinese Exclusionary Act was policy for 70 years.
Correct. And again, I forget the acronym that the senator from Arkansas said. It was something like SMART or something to that effect, where that's essentially what he's doing. Figure out what kind of people we need here, engineers, physicists, scientists, and so on. Make it easy for them to come here, but people that we don't need here, frankly, we don't make it easy for them to come here.
Yeah, and I mean, integration is important because, you know, as of right now in a lot of developing countries, the United States we're not having enough babies. We're not having enough babies to, you know, replace the older generation, and we can, you know, that's a whole different other show. But we need to bring in labor, and especially we need to bring in skilled labor. And so it makes sense to me that, you know, the Secretary of State, like you said, would prioritize people, high-skilled laborers that can come in here and really contribute to our economy, right?
Exactly. And again, you mentioned in our show prep today that it creates a problem sometime, because if you're hiring people here from, or bringing them in here, let's say from India, because they have the skills that the United States needs, they can end up replacing American citizens in these high-paying scientific jobs, and that creates a little bit of a problem.
A little bit, but I mean, I think the answer to that, though, is to encourage United States citizens to become doctors, lawyers, and engineers.
Exactly.
And I think that is reflective in the educational system. And that's
correct.
A different topic for a different day. You guys are going to talk a little bit more about immigration right after the break. Two cases, Dawson versus Garland, Romero versus Garland, both out of the Ninth Circuit. And then we're going to talk about the Fourth Amendment. So you guys were here in the Legal Lounge, CRN Digital Talk Radio, CRNTalk.com. Make sure to check out Richard's fantastic book. It'll make a fantastic Father's Day gift, America, An Illusion of Freedom. It's available wherever fine books are sold, iTunes, Barnes & Noble, and Amazon.com. Stay with us.
It's been tough talking to my doctor about constipation with belly pain, discomfort, and bloating. I finally laid all my symptoms out there and how they keep coming back. She said I may have irritable bowel syndrome with constipation, or IBS-C. We agreed it's time to try something different.
Linzess, or linaclotide, is a prescription medicine that treats IBS-C in adults. Linzess works differently than laxatives. It lets you have more frequent and complete bowel movements and helps relieve overall abdominal symptoms, belly pain, discomfort, and bloating. These symptoms were studied in combination, not individually. Do not give Linzess to children less than 6, and it should not be given to children 6 to less than 18. It may harm them. Do not take Linzess if you have a bowel blockage. Get immediate help if you develop unusual or severe stomach pain, especially with bloody or black stools. The most common side effect is diarrhea, sometimes severe. If it's severe, stop taking Linzess and call your doctor right away. Other side effects include gas, stomach area pain, and swelling. There could be more to your story with IBS-C. Visit a doctor in person or online. Say yes to Linzess. Learn more at Linzess.com or call 1-800-LINZESS. Sponsored by Abbvie and Ironwood Pharmaceuticals.
The smartest way for you to get the lowest prices on your plane tickets, domestic or international, is to call SmartFares, first or last, but you've got to call us before you book your plane tickets. Fly anywhere in the world, fly anywhere in the U.S., and SmartFares can save you up to 75% on your plane tickets. We have the lowest airline ticket prices on over 500 airlines, and you've got a great 12-hour free cancellation window. Plus, with our live agent help, you can always get fast help and fast answers. So on your next trip, maybe today, maybe tomorrow, how about right now? Pick up your phone and call SmartFares. Plus, save up to 75% on your plane reservation. So call right now. 800-915-2644. 800-915-2644. 800-915-2644. 800-915-2644.
The old way of living with diabetes is a pain. You've got to remember to do your testing, and you always need to be sticking your fingers. The new way to live your life with diabetes is with a continuous glucose monitor. You simply apply a discreet, easy-to-use sensor on your body, and it continuously monitors your glucose levels, helping you spend more time in range and freeing you from painful finger pricks. If you test your blood sugar at least 4 times per day and inject insulin at least 3 times per day, or use an insulin pump and have private insurance or Medicare, you might be eligible for a CGM with little or no cost to you. Call U.S. Medical Supply today for a free benefits check. We offer free shipping, 90-day supplies, and we bill Medicare or your insurance directly. Call now and say goodbye to finger pricks.
800-633-1378. 800-633-1378. 800-633-1378. That's 800-633-1378.
We are back in the Legal Lounge, CRN Digital Talk Radio, CRNTalk.com. To round out this discussion we were having here on immigration, two recent cases adjudicated by the Ninth Circuit have come down the pipe. And this first one, Dawson versus Garland. This one's very interesting to me because I think this kind of shows the, I wouldn't necessarily say the abuse, but I'd say the gaming of the asylum system. This is regarding the Convention Against Torture. What are the facts of this case, Richard?
Yes, very briefly. Carlina Dawson is a native and citizen of Jamaica who started around 1992 making multiple unlawful entries into the United States. And in late 2009-2010, Dawson was arrested for shoplifting and had an outstanding warrant from a 1996 drug charge. In July of 2010, Dawson was sentenced to 63 months in prison for unlawful importation and so on. Anyway, February of 2019, Dawson attempted to re-enter the United States by claiming to be a United States citizen. Immigration inspectors determined she was not a citizen. And then she expressed a fear of returning to Jamaica and was found to possess a credible fear of persecution if returned. In the ensuing removal proceedings, she sought deferral removal under certain provisions. The Ninth Circuit basically said that the Board of Immigration Appeals properly denied petitioner's application for deferral of removal under Convention Against Torture because petitioner's circumstances changed significantly after Jamaican court issued a preventive order. So basically she was saying that if I go back there, my husband or my live-in is going to beat me up because he's got a history of that. The court found that that was no longer the case and that the Jamaican courts had more or less taken care of that situation.
Yeah, there's two prongs here. I read this case pretty extensively. And the credible threat of persecution claim for asylum was based on that her abusive partner knew somebody who knew somebody who worked for the government.
Yes.
Number two, the Convention Against Torture, which, you know, is international law. You really don't want to send, you know, someone back to their home country to have their feet beaten or anything like that. But this was a domestic violence situation, not state-sponsored torture from the actual government itself. And so the Convention Against Torture argument she made, where if she was deported back to Jamaica, she'd be subject to torture. The spirit of law says that you don't want to send somebody back to Myanmar or someone back to, you know, Turkey or something like that to get tortured by the government itself.
That's correct. And all the court really did here was to deny she's trying to stall the removal proceedings, and all the court did here in the Ninth Circuit was saying, no, the removal proceedings must proceed. Again, she may have other ways of arguing that she must be able to stay here, but so far she's on her way out.
But this case is a perfect example of how some use the asylum, claiming asylum, to game the system.
Absolutely. Their lawyers tell them those magic words. They might know only six words in English, but one of those six is, "I'm here for asylum."
Well, not even. I don't think they're told by their. I'm sure they are told by their lawyer upon arrest. But what they also are told that by the coyotes, by the ones that actually pay to get them to the border, and then the coyotes say, "Hey, all you have to do is just say asylum, and you're all set." So maybe, you know, to address the immigration problem, we might need to address the asylum policies of this country.
Absolutely. And of course, that's one of the things that I believe it's Stephen Miller, he's the president of the First American Legal Foundation. And he's challenged the policy of Mr. Biden at the southern border, Mr. Biden and Ms. Harris, saying that this is the most unprotected border in recent years. And that there are millions and millions, maybe 42 million people that would like to come in, and they'll all come in if we keep the border open. And he's saying that we must end catch and release. And so far that's not happening, but it looks like he may succeed because he's got his ducks in order and that there's a pending lawsuit. So let's see how that works out.
Yeah, he's a friend of the show, Stephen Miller. I believe he's a local boy, too, out of Santa Monica High. So there you go. We'll be looking to these immigration cases moving forward. And we'll see if, President Biden. Well, let me ask you this, Richard, real fast. Has President Biden and Vice President Harris, have they actually been to the border since they've been elected?
I don't think so. And, you know, they have to know what's going on, because even if they don't go, of course, there are people that work for them in the executive branch. They're certainly privy to what's going on Fox and other stations that tell us, they tell me, I know, and they tell you probably, every night there's news from the southern border and all the tragedies and kids drowning and so on, and they're just allowing it to continue, and they're acting like ostriches by putting their head in the sand and ignoring it, but it's not going to work.
Sweep it under the rug. All right, folks, be right back. Talk about the Fourth Amendment. Stick around.
CRN listeners, listen to CRN every day on your smartphone. Get our CRN app by dialing #250 on your smartphone. When the call is answered, just say CRN as the code word. Then accept the one-time text, and our CRN app will be loaded to your phone. It's that easy. Just dial #250 on your smartphone and say CRN, and start enjoying CRN wherever you go. Dial #250 and say CRN.
Fred Dreyer here. Join me at the Ramp Bar and Grill in Burbank, California. Now open with indoor dining. Monday through Thursday, noon to 9, Friday, noon to 10, and Saturday, 4 to 10. Happy hour weekdays from 2 to 7 p.m. It's the home of the $5 margarita, by the way. Start with mouth-watering charbroiled chicken nachos, the best cheesy garlic bread in town, steamed clams and delicious soups and fresh salads, the best burgers in town, and steaks? Oh, you bet. Yum. Ribeye, filet, even prime rib. Italian specialties too. Ravioli, linguine, cappellini, pomodoro, chicken parmesan, and a lot more. Save room for desserts too, including homemade cheesecake. It's the Ramp Bar and Grill, 7730 North Hollywood Way, minutes from Burbank Airport. Call 818-768-6499. Takeout and Postmates delivery too. Open Mother's Day from 1 to 9 p.m. Reserve your tables now. Call 818-768-6499.
The smartest way for you to get the lowest prices on your plane tickets, domestic or international, is to call SmartFares, first or last, but you've got to call us before you book your plane tickets. Fly anywhere in the world, fly anywhere in the U.S., and SmartFares can save you up to 75% on your plane tickets. We have the lowest airline ticket prices on over 500 airlines, and you've got a great 12-hour free cancellation window. Plus, with our live agent help, you can always get fast help and fast answers. So on your next trip, maybe today, maybe tomorrow, how about right now? Pick up your phone and call SmartFares. Plus, save up to 75% on your plane reservation. So call right now. 800-915-2644. 800-915-2644. 800-915-2644. 800-915-2644.
The old way of living with diabetes is a pain. You've got to remember to do your testing, and you always need to be sticking your fingers. The new way to live your life with diabetes is with a continuous glucose monitor. You simply apply a discreet, easy-to-use sensor on your body, and it continuously monitors your glucose levels, helping you spend more time in range and freeing you from painful finger pricks. If you test your blood sugar at least 4 times per day and inject insulin at least 3 times per day, or use an insulin pump and have private insurance or Medicare, you might be eligible for a CGM with little or no cost to you. Call U.S. Medical Supply today for a free benefits check. We offer free shipping, 90-day supplies, and we bill Medicare or your insurance directly. Call now and say goodbye to finger pricks.
800-633-1378. 800-633-1378. 800-633-1378. That's 800-633-1378.
Want to catch the latest news on your favorite CRN show hosts and personalities? Head to our CRN online magazine and discover the latest adventures from food expert Meryl Schindler, Mike Horn, and Debbie Barrera. Wine news with Larry Lipson, Alan Balik, and Michael Jordan. News from the CRN Lounge with Fred Dreyer, Mike Horn, Mike Gary, Richard Nixon, Jeremy Dayton, and so much more. Just go to CRNTalk.com and click on the CRN magazine.
We are back in the Legal Lounge, CRN Digital Talk Radio, CRNTalk.com. It's time for one of my favorite parts of the show, to talk about the criminal law. Fourth Amendment, Richard. We hear a lot about it in Law and Order. Yeah. We hear a lot about it in old movies. What is the Fourth Amendment?
Okay, we have to read the Fourth Amendment to start with now. You were kind enough to give us a nice fresh copy, one that's big enough for me to read, Mike. Anyway, the Fourth Amendment of the U.S. Constitution provides that the right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures. Now, underline the word unreasonable, shall not be violated, and no warrants shall issue but upon probable cause, supported by oath or affirmation, and particularly describing the place to be searched and the persons or things to be seized. So I underline the word unreasonable because it's clear that the government has the authority to go into your house, violate your privacy, if you will, to a certain extent, your person, your house, your papers and effects, provided it's reasonable. And that's what the courts have, and the Congress has been fighting since the Fourth Amendment was written in 1791, is establishing some kind of reasonableness or boundary for which the government can intrude on a person's privacy.
And the balance here is that the government is trying to attempt is the, you know, civil society, the safety of civil society versus, yes, an individual's right to privacy, correct?
Right, right.
But what we've seen is that the Fourth Amendment has three exceptions. What are those exceptions?
Well, three. You say three, but that's so far, Mike. In the last couple of weeks, we've already found we've got a new one this week. Now, you remember a couple of weeks ago we talked about the plain view doctrine, and that was requires that the police officer be where he has a right to be. For instance, in one case, He was summoned to a house because someone had heard gunshots. The police went into the house. The house was, I guess, pretty ramshackle. And they noticed a, what looked like a brand new stereo set. And the police officer moved the stereo set to read the serial number. And upon searching, found out that that was stolen. So he confiscated the stereo set and arrested the people. And upon the defendant bringing a motion to suppress under the exception to the Fourth Amendment here, the police were not able to prosecute for that because the court held that the police have a right to be where they were, yes, but if they're going to use open view, they cannot move anything or touch anything. It's only those things that are presently viewable by the officers. So that's one exception.
So just real fast, so by moving it, by turning it over and looking at the serial number, that was out of plain view. If that serial number was on top where the officer could just look at it without moving, it would have been fine under the plain view doctrine.
That's correct, and that's why we kind of jokingly said it requires the police to bring with them an Alan Dershowitz to make these distinctions between what he can do and what he can't. Another example that we had the other day was the community caretaking function, and that was a situation where someone got into an automobile accident. The police arrived. The person was, I think, unable to negotiate or to move. And when the police did an inventory of the car, they found some contraband and tried to prosecute on that. And the Supreme Court simply said, very simply, and I'll read the summary, a recognition of the existence of community caretaking issues, tasks, like rendering aid to motorists is disabled in disabled vehicles, is not an open-ended license to perform searches anywhere. Therefore, the First Circuit erred in applying this particular case because what is reasonable for vehicles is different from what is reasonable for homes. And therefore, they found that the this was an open-ended search. They had no right to do that.
Yeah, you mentioned the broken down car, or you see somebody maybe he's in distress health wise on the side of the road, and the community caretaker exception is I'm looking at this case Commonwealth versus Walters, which activities performed by officers that are quote totally divorced from the detection, investigation, or acquisition of evidence relating to the violation of a criminal statute. So kind of like call that the coincidence law, where like if I get rear-ended. And my, the police officer comes in, oh, I see you got rear-ended, and my trunk flies open, and they see that I have a machine gun back there, that evidence can be admissible.
Can be, because, again, it's plain view. But then we have the third situation is a so-called exigent circumstances, where this is another case where this is a Ninth Circuit case, where the district court erred by denying defendant's suppression motion. But error was harmless due to his strength of other evidence, such as the defendant's DNA and robbery. So in other words, what happened here is the police had a right to be where they were. Defendant brought a motion to suppress whatever evidence the police had found. And sure enough, the lower court granted the motion to suppress, meaning that they couldn't use that evidence against him. However, the Ninth Circuit surprisingly held, but the other evidence was so overwhelming that it didn't matter if they could use that suppressed evidence, because the evidence regarding his DNA and the robbery handgun were sufficient to justify the conviction.
Yeah, that's kind of like the fruit from the poison tree, but that fruit was not poisonous. Like if I get pulled over and I'm covered in blood, I mean, that's an exigent circumstance right there, right?
Correct. Yes. And again, what we've got is carve-outs. So far, three of them, Mike, that we've done in the last couple weeks. All of these carve-outs are done by the Supreme Court or lower courts sometime, and the Supreme Court just kind of rubber stamps them. But none of these were done by Congress, and that's one of the main objections I have in my book, basically, is we might agree with these exceptions. We might think, well, good, I'm glad they couldn't prosecute a defendant for this or that or that. However, we've got nine unelected individuals making these decisions for the rest of the people, for 300 million people, when Congress should be making those decisions and Congress should be responsible. If the people don't like those decisions, Congress should be responsible and be held out for the next election.
That's an interesting point. I want to talk more about that after the break. And that aforementioned book, American Illusion of Freedom,
very
is available wherever fine books are sold. Makes a great Father's Day gift. Available at Amazon.com, Barnes & Noble, and on iTunes. Stick around.
If Ernest Hemingway was alive today, would he say this to you?
Shakespeare, Mark Twain, Edgar Allan Poe, all great writers. And after reading your book, I simply must add you to the list.
Wait, you don't have a book yet. So make a free call to Page Publishing. Their expert staff can help you turn your book idea into a real book, a masterpiece that could someday make the bestseller list in hard copy and digitally all across the world. Page Publishing can help you completely take your idea for a book, write it, and publish it. So if you want to join the ranks of some of the most famous authors in the world, call now for a free information kit. Turn your book idea into publishing gold. Make a free call right now to Page Publishing.
800-378-3212. 800-378-3212. 800-378-3212. That's 800-378-3212.
Imagine this is your money and someone wants to take it from you. Who is it? The IRS. They want your money, and guess what? They can legally take it, all of it if they want. Remember, they sent you that letter that said, hey, you owe us a bunch of cash and we're gonna take it from you. So what do? Fight back by letting our team of experts at the Tax Helpline work it out with the IRS so you can keep your money. And we're good at what we do. When you hire us, you get a team of guys on your side that know the IRS laws and will fight to save your money. So if you owe the IRS a ton of cash and you want to keep it, call right now and learn for free how we can help you put it back in your pocket.
800-932-1597. 800-932-1597. 800-932-1597. That's 800-932-1597.
And we are back in the Legal Lounge. Make sure to follow Richard on Twitter at RichardANixon1, on Parlor at PRES37TH. Email him, PRES37TH@AOL.com. And all that information is available if you are watching this on YouTube in the description of the video below. So, Richard, these exceptions to the Fourth Amendment, the open view doctrine, the community caretaker function, and exigent circumstances, what recourse does, if my Fourth Amendment rights have been violated, what recourse do I have against the state?
Well, that's right. We've talked about this before, the so-called exclusionary doctrine, which again is another doctrine created by the courts, not by the Congress. So the people had no say in it. But basically what it says is that if you bring a motion when this evidence is to be presented to the court in trial, if the defendant brings a motion to suppress, the court will evaluate it and basically say that it's a violation of, again, in this case, the Fourth Amendment, and it cannot be used against you, against the defendant. And if the defendant wins that motion, then that evidence cannot be used against him. However, it doesn't mean the case is done. If there is other evidence, the prosecutor can go forward. But it's basically a court-made doctrine that allows the defendant to sometimes get away with it.
But and like you said, the court-made doctrine.
Yes.
I mean, these exceptions that you just talked about, you know, these three exceptions to the Fourth Amendment, those are court-made doctrines as well.
Absolutely.
I mean, who's making law here, Richard?
Well, that's right. And that's what I rail against in my book, is that we may agree with these ideas. Maybe these are great ideas.
Yeah, yeah.
Were they done by the legislature or by Congress, we might agree that, yes, we should have some kind of protections from the police just doing these things. However, we refer now to Article 1, which we do on occasion. We actually read the Constitution. And Article 1, Section 1 says, all legislative powers herein granted shall be vested in a Congress of the United States which shall consist of a House and a House, which consist of a Senate and House of Representatives. So it doesn't say some, it says all legislative powers. And therefore, neither the President nor the Supreme Court is really authorized to make law, yet they do it every time that the Supreme Court passes or introduces a new doctrine, they are writing law.
Well, I'm going to throw this to you out of left field. I mean, we talked about the Fourth Amendment. It's the state, you know, balancing security and safety versus the expectation of privacy of an individual.
Right.
If I'm subject to an invasive search by the state and I'm cleared of all wrongdoing, do I have any damage? Can I actually maybe sue the government in civil court for them violating my privacy?
Well, theoretically, yes, but the idea, the burden will be on, of course, the plaintiff to prove damage. But what is your damage if, for instance, someone takes your AR-15 away from you? The court is going to be reluctant, depending on the court's political assuasion, whether to return that gun to you or not. But it's possible that you can receive damages. I know that there are people who have been incarcerated for years who did file suit and got quite a bit of money back.
Mm-hmm.
So it is possible if the police abuse your privacy to a large extent to win. But again, in this country, both sides must pay their own attorney's fees. So the plaintiff is always aware of the fact that if he loses, he's got to pay his attorney's fees, and he may not be a deep pocket person to be able to do that.
And he can only sue the institution behind the officers. He can't sue the prosecutor or the officer because of qualified immunity and also because of absolute immunity, right?
That's right. He can't sue the judge or the prosecutor because of absolute immunity. The so-called qualified immunity only applies to civil cases.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously we know from the a recent case here at Thomas, can't remember the name, where the 9 seconds or 9 minutes of on the police on
the George Floyd
neck.
Case. Yeah, the
George Floyd case. We know from that experience that the police officer can be prosecuted for a violation of the criminal law. So that's one of the remedies. Now, what happens usually if a person is found guilty of that, the city will end up making a deal so it doesn't go any further. And I understand in that case, the people, the remaining family did get something like $20 million.
Yeah, about $25 million. Yeah, that's still being adjudicated too. And it's interesting if you juxtapose that, all the rules, regulations, and tests one U.S. citizen faces vis-a-vis law enforcement regarding. And then you look at some of the tests and that's an illegal alien sees. I mean, we see catch and release for illegal aliens for violating a federal statute. And then if a U.S. citizen violates a federal statute, sometimes, didn't you say that the punishment can be even harsher sometimes?
Well, yes, that's what I've heard. Now, I don't know how far this went. I don't know if it's actually established law or just talk. But I understood it was in California that if two people, for instance, commit the same offense, maybe together.
Yeah, let's say two people get a DUI.
Yes. The one citizen will get a higher, if you will, jail sentence than the non-citizens because they consider the fact that the non-citizen might be deported.
Might be is the operative word there.
Might be deported, and therefore that's part of his punishment. So the citizen might get 2 years, if you will, and the non-citizen might get a year because they consider that deportation might be in the offing.
Yeah, and once again, to underline that the theoretical deportation might be considered a sanction.
Correct.
So stick around, you guys. We're going to wrap things up with a big big story out of California. So stick around in the Legal Lounge, CRN Digital Talk Radio, CRNTalk.com, Facebook.com/CRNTalk. Stick around.
You order a glass of your favorite Cabernet, fresh asparagus, hollandaise on the side, a filet, medium rare. You unfurl your napkin with a flair, close your eyes, and prepare to listen. Ah, there it is. The sweet music you long to hear. The sizzle
The sizzle of a Ruth's Chris steak.
The most magnificent corn-fed prime beef, broiled to perfection at 1,800 degrees. Some call it a sizzle. We call it an anthem.
As the waiter approaches, you think, is this one mine or that one?
Ruth's Chris Steakhouse. Like Ruth always said, life's too short to eat anywhere else.
Make a reservation online at rootschris.com or by calling 800-544-0808.
Hi, my name is Lily. My mom and dad used to fight about money all the time. Then one day, I heard them talking about this guy. Some uncle I never knew called Uncle Sam. Well, they say this Uncle Sam guy wanted them to pay him like a gazillion dollars. And they didn't have a gazillion dollars. So they called this company they heard on the radio called the Tax Doctor. And the Tax Doctor worked with Uncle Sam's people. I think they're called the IRS. And they're able to work it out so my mom and dad didn't have to pay Uncle Sam very much money at all. So now mom and dad are happy, and I'm happy too. Thanks, Tax Doctor.
If you owe $10,000 or more to the IRS or state, call now and pay less. 800-391-8713. 800-391-8713. That's 800-391-8713.
CRN listeners, listen to CRN every day on your smartphone. Get our CRN app by dialing #250 on your smartphone. When the call is answered, just say CRN as the code word. Then accept the one-time text, and our CRN app will be loaded to your phone. It's that easy. Just dial #250 on your smartphone and say CRN, and start enjoying CRN wherever you go. Dial #250 and say CRN.
Trying to sell your old car? Instead, donate your vehicle to Heritage for the Blind. Pickup is free, and your donation is tax deductible. Just call 1-800-785-9618. Heritage for the Blind accepts cars, vans, trucks, and boats, whether they run or not. Call right now and receive a free 3-day vacation voucher to over 50 locations. Call 1-800-785-9618. Donate your car today. That's 1-800-785-9618.
And we are back in the Legal Lounge, CRN Digital Talk Radio, CRNTalk.com. We're going to talk about this briefly because we're running out of time, but this is going to be a huge issue in the coming weeks. This happened late last night. The California ban on assault weapons, which has been around as long as I've been alive, pretty much, has been ruled unconstitutional by a federal judge. A federal judge in California ruled that the state's ban on assault weapons is unconstitutional. U.S. Judge Roger Benitez of San Diego. We've talked about him before. The 30-year-old ban was an overstep of state government and a violation of the Constitution's Second Amendment. Quotes, this case is not about extraordinary weapons lying in the outer limits of Second Amendment protection. The banned assault weapons are not bazookas, howitzers, or machine guns.
Correct.
Those arms are dangerous and solely used for military purposes, Benitez wrote. Instead, the firearms deemed assault weapons are fairly ordinary, popular, modern rifles. This is an average case about average guns used in average ways for average purposes. And specifically, I think he's talking about the AR-15 and its variants, which is the second highest selling firearm in all of America. Richard, your thoughts, because this is going to be a big story moving forward.
I think it is. And what we should do is review what the Second Amendment actually says. So I look into the Constitution, and it says that a well-regulated militia, being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. Now, it's interesting what that says. It's basically saying that the federal government shall not infringe, meaning limit, a person's right to keep and bear arms. Now, the Supreme Court has already held that this is not a right of the state, it's a right of the people. And it's an individual right. And they've determined, of course, that a person has a right to keep a loaded gun in his home for self-defense. Those two cases held that was...
Yeah, Heller and McDonald.
Yes. So there's no question that, frankly, as far as the federal government goes, there should be no law restricting it. Now, the states have some if you will, authorization to take some action regarding which guns or which situations are appropriate under the Second Amendment. However, this federal judge said that they're going a little bit too far by taking a particular weapon that they choose because apparently of it, because of the way it looks like a dangerous weapon, and therefore it's got to be banned. And as what you righteously just said, Mike, it's just the average gun used by the average person for the average person purpose, and therefore he could see no reason to violate the Second Amendment.
So this doesn't necessarily mean that anybody here in California can just run out to Turner's Outdoors and pick up an unregulated AR-15. The Benitez, the judge in question here, he allowed for a 30-day stay before his ruling takes effect, allowing California Attorney General Rob Bonta, the defendant in this case, to appeal. So is this going to go to the Supreme Court, you think?
Probably will. And you see, I'm glad you mentioned that, because this is one of the great hallmarks of this country, as much as people like to knock it, is in almost all situations, the courts will allow or even demand that both sides be heard, rather than the judge simply throwing on the gauntlet and saying, this is it, it's unconstitutional, go home. He says, okay, I want to hear the other side.
Yeah.
I want everybody to have a fair shot. And the other part of due process is that you have a reason to argue very strenuously on your side. So we don't want anybody there with a very weak argument. We want the person who has been harmed, which gets back to the whole standing issue. We want the person in before the judge who's been hurt and will give us his strongest argument on both sides, so that the judge is totally enlightened and can make an enlightened decision.
Yeah. Richard, we're out of time, but this case is going to be interesting to look forward, especially with the conservative majority on the Supreme Court. Richard, thank you very much.
You're so much. You're so welcome.
We'll see you guys next week. As always, all previous sessions are available on YouTube. Just find CRN Digital Talk's YouTube page and find Richard's playlist. Also available on podcast at crntalk.com/podcast. Air America and Illusion of Freedom. Available wherever fine books are sold. See you guys next week here in the Legal Lounge.